The country's health system is facing serious challenges. And amongst those challenges, we are seeing the health personnel, particularly the medical doctors, down in twos. In recent days, we have seen junior doctors downing their tools, and to date, government has fired nearly 500 of these doctors because of the industrial action. Only yesterday, senior doctors joined their junior counterparts in the strike. In the hospitals, reports are there is a serious crisis in our hospitals, and some health personnel are saying it's a silent genocide. To get more of the overview of the current health situation in the country today, we are going to talk to Dr. Madzorera, who is the Secretary for Health and Child Welfare in the MDC Alliance. Dr. Madzorera, a medical practitioner, was also a former cabinet minister in the same portfolio of health and child welfare during the inclusive government. Good afternoon, Doctor.
Good afternoon, William. Thank you very much, William. The matter you have raised is a very serious matter to the people of Zimbabwe. We have seen the country sliding down into a very terrible precipice over the last 88 days. And this is roughly how long the strike of junior doctors has been going on. Remember, in Zimbabwe, we already have a shortage of doctors, a serious shortage. Without this current crisis, we have a total of about 1,900 doctors in the whole country. That's not enough for the country. Remember, many of these are in private practice. We can't tell you exactly how many are in government practice because people do double up in private, public, NGOs, and so forth. But all I can tell you is we have a general shortage of human resources in the country, especially doctors. Now, our government has already fired over 450 of these junior doctors and middle-level doctors. These are the foundation of the healthcare delivery system. Remember, our healthcare delivery system functions as a unit from top to bottom. The senior doctors can't work without the junior doctors. The junior doctors can't work without the nurses and other ancillary staff. If you take out any layer of healthcare workers from this, the system collapses. So we have a system that has not been working now for 88 days. And the government is making matters worse by firing doctors. Just yesterday, from about 1400 hours, we know that the consultants, the senior doctors, also downed tools, complaining that they can't work anymore because they can't function without the junior doctors. And we hear, we are reliably informed, that 58 of them have already been served with letters to appear before a disciplinary committee. Now, that's very serious. If you fire all the junior doctors, you want to fire all the consultants, who is going to remain to do the work? I can confirm that at the current moment, at this state, all our central hospitals, nearly all of them, are closed. Go to Paranyapa, you will not see patients in the casualty department, you won't see patients in the wards. And where are these patients going? We are talking about a very serious genocide here, which we cannot quantify, but people are dying in their homes. People are beginning to seek health care from sangomas, from prayers, and from other unusual sources of help because the government had chosen to pay a deaf ear to the plight of the people of Zimbabwe.
Right, Doctor, thank you very much on that. You have already maybe answered the question which I was going to ask you, which is the impact of this strike maybe on the general population. You have highlighted there are no doctors to man the hospitals. You have highlighted patients have nowhere to go. Do you want to add maybe anything more about the impact this strike has caused on the general population?
Yes, there is a lot more to be said about the impact. In fact, it's much more serious than we can even begin to fathom. And it's made worse by some kind of lack of understanding of our government of what the healthcare delivery system actually does, what doctors actually go to work to do every day. when you see senior members of the government doing a whole show to reward a traditional midwife in Bari for conducting a 100 deliveries under unhygienic circumstances, under circumstances where there is no infection control, no antiseptics, under circumstances where there is no prevention of mother-to-child transmission of HIV, there is no antenatal clinics, there is no postnatal clinics, there is no management of complications. When those patients start bleeding, the traditional midwife does not know what to do. We have had traditional midwives before. In around about 2004, we stopped the system of using traditional midwives because of the massive mortality and morbidity that resulted from traditional midwives. But you see, our government, they think that's a solution to the problem. They think we can replace doctors and nurses with traditional midwives. And that's very serious. So the impact, we have thousands of people who are dying. We don't know where they are dying. They are seeking health care from sambomas and other places. So you have somebody with intestinal obstruction who goes to a sambom and gets told you will be bewitched by so and so. My friend, if your intestines are knotted up, you need a doctor, a surgeon, to open up and straighten up your intestines. If you have got an obstructed hernia, a strangulated hernia, you need a doctor who can open up and straighten it up. If you can't give birth normally, you need an obstetrician who will open up and take out the baby before you develop a vesicovaginal fistula. And there are many consequences we are going to be seeing over the next few months and years, which have not yet been revealed right now. We are going to see an increase in the number of children with cerebral palsy, for example, because of obstructed liver. We are going to see a lot of an upsurge of HIV transmission from mother to child over the next few months and years, because the PMTCT program is broken down, and so that's the impact. Now take this and cascade it all the departments, the dozens of departments in a hospital, and you can begin to have a feel of the scale of the carnage, the genocide that is going on. No one can quantify the exact level of genocide, but we know it's massive, because these people are just dying in the homes, in the villages, and no one is recording the deaths.
That is quite an unfortunate situation. It's quite a serious situation. How have we come to be where we are right now? What really caused us to be in this crisis?
This crisis has developed slowly over the years. It's not something that just came up overnight. But what has happened is, I would say, even health workers, out of the goodness of their heart, have contributed to this crisis. You see, the system has been bad. The government has been underfunding health care for a long time. They've not been retooling the hospitals. They've not been improving the working conditions of health workers. Health workers have just been stitching together, you know, a torn blanket, a torn garment, as it were, stitching it together. Every time it's torn, they stitch it together. And imagine you've got your pants and you get a tear, stitch it together instead of telling your father that my pants are torn. And you get another. You get to a stage where every bit of it is stitched together and you can't stitch anymore. That's where we've gotten to. Now we are walking around naked. It has taken a long time, and Zimbabwe is now naked. There is no healthcare delivery system. And now we are crying. So it's two issues: poor remuneration and not retooling the hospitals, not reinvesting in equipment and infrastructure, not reinvesting in consumables within the hospitals, and things have fallen apart.
Doctor, in conclusion, what do you think government must do to address this crisis that we have at hand right now?
That is where the government should show its maturity and its wisdom. And I must say, both those elements have been lacking so far. The government should engage the doctors in the entire healthcare delivery system at once. The government wants to talk to the doctors, but they want to talk to doctors whom they fired. There is no contract between the government and the fired doctor. The government should immediately re-engage all the doctors within the public health system, bring them back. We are fully aware that doctors are getting out of the country. And if you talk to the regulatory authority, they will tell you they are getting hundreds of applications every day. Doctors wanting their letters of good standing to go and practice outside of Zimbabwe. And so we are losing those doctors as we speak, and the government thinks they've got an upper hand on the situation. No, the doctors are leaving. The government should readmit them into the public service immediately before they all leave. They should come up with a plan of improving their conditions of service. Let's say the doctors want $1,000 a month, changed into some dollars by the bank, going bankrupt. The government should be humble enough to say, guys, we don't have $1,000 for you per month, but we can give you $200. Come, let's sit down. We give you $200 this month, and after 3 months we increase it $250, and after 3 months we increase it until we reach the target salary that you think you're worth. I tell you, doctors will play ball. They are humans, they understand the situation, they don't want their patients to suffer. They are prepared to negotiate and compromise as they have done in the past. As long as they can have this agreement in writing, as a true and sincere agreement, not as has happened in the past. We are fully aware that the government has made agreements in the past with doctors and they've broken their agreements midway. If they make agreements in earnest and they sign, the doctors sign, the government signs, and they follow up with the program so that after so many months the doctors know they are now earning what they should be earning, I tell you it will work. The second thing is the issue of retooling and re-equipping the hospitals. We know that they don't have as much money as they need to have, but the government should make an undertaking again to improve. They can't improve the whole hospital at one time. Let them learn from what we did during the inclusive government with what we call the target. And we targeted specific institutions. First of all, we targeted the four central hospitals, Harare, Barone, Pilo, UBH. We gave them money, and we didn't give them money to do everything. We told them, deal with this critical area first. I remember the critical areas included the boilers, the laundry, the autoclaves, things like that. And as you deal with one area at a time, one department at a time, you gain the confidence of healthcare workers. And after some months, you go into another area. During the time of the inclusive government, we managed to retool the central hospitals, and we went beyond that. Using the targeted approach, we started retooling even mission hospitals, general hospitals, provincial hospitals, and so forth. And it worked. If they had continued with that momentum, I know it would be somewhere. So that's the second thing. Let there be a signed agreement on retooling and re-equipping the hospitals. And I think if we do that, our healthcare delivery system will come back online. The last thing I want to say is, let the government have a change of approach to healthcare workers. Let them respect healthcare workers and know that the healthcare workers know more about healthcare than the politicians do. Let them give them an ear, let them respect them and pay them properly. We are busy right now supporting healthcare systems in other countries, neighboring countries, Botswana, South Africa. It's Zimbabweans who are running those healthcare systems and our own people here. Suffering and dying because of lack of healthcare workers. So we urge the government to have some respect for healthcare workers.
That was the insight from Dr. Henry Madzorera on the current situation of health in the country. Doctor, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, William. You're welcome.